a value-based but also a policy-based profession. Sometimes these may conflict, but then you have to deal with that. How?
Maybe some of these things will help you.
What is that policy saying? How do you understand that policy? What is that values are here? And what is the social work values are saying? And how can I, you know, juggle with all this, you know? It's like a puzzle. And you, by doing, you learn. And that is where the code of ethics, another interesting thing that we may go into this. So to understand that, I think policy analysis models, policy evaluation, policy making process, the very understanding about these things is very important. For what? To engage, to merge, you know, or to find answers when there is a value conflict, or to promote these values that you believe in. I'm sure these policies and the knowledge about these policies will really help you to promote whatever values that you believe. There is always an ethical dilemma there, and how do we manage these ethical dilemmas? Again, you go back to the what is my profession says. There are I think five. It's just a little out of the stuff, but I think this one. There are five useful ways that you can learn. Okay, what? As a social worker, you have a responsibility for your profession, right? So you look at your professional values. As a social worker, you have a responsibility to the society, societal values. As a social worker, you are responsible to your organization, organizational values. As a social worker, you are responsible for your client. As a social worker, you are responsible for your colleagues. So look at all these and then make a decision. It looks very clear, very complex now, but it happens just like that. It happens here. It's a very complex thing that happens here.
What is the last one?
The colleagues. Social colleagues.
Colleagues.
Sorry, colleagues. Like you are working with a peer. You got it? For example, you are working in an NGO. Your colleague has a different opinion, and you have a different opinion. Both of them are social workers. You can't say that you are wrong and I am right. It happens in medicine. Oh, that doctor is useless. If you go to the doctor, you will die. They may use these practices. But in social work, you are not supposed to do that. You cannot criticize, or maybe you will be able to criticize, but openly, or it should be a constructive feedback. So you have responsibilities to your colleagues, you have responsibility to your clients, you have responsibilities to your organization, you have responsibility to the society, and you are responsible for the whole profession. So these are the five areas that you think, and you the decisions that you make will be okay, because you will be thinking, you know, Am I making the right decision? Will my colleagues say yes? Is it in compliance with the, you know, national values? Is it in compliance with the social work values? Is it in compliance with my organizational values? So these things happen here, and the decisions that you make is not just your own strong feelings, but it's a rational one. That is where we come into this. Okay, now what I suggest is that before I go into this, today I want to do a little different thing. I want to ask those case studies, just take 5 minutes each and present here, and then we'll go to this analysis and evaluation, because the presentation that you will make, knowingly, unknowingly, you're using this already. So we'll see that. Who wants to volunteer? Just two presentations, any two teams who have done on the same topic, like refugees or another case. What is that? The communities, whatever, just two people, give us your analysis, and we will see what influenced your analysis. Is it values, or is it national policies, or is it social work, or is it whatever, your own values, what is that influence, we will see. Shall we do that? Or you want to see the theory first? I think I would prefer that one, the case thing, so that we can relate.
Back in her own country, and among
between the two children, one of the children is having a medical problem which is being identified as autism, but it's a developmental problem. I think all of you know about autism. So, and they also having problem in paying the rental for the house which they are staying. So, this is the scenario happening. So, as the as a social worker, what is Mr. Habib going to do for this family? So, so when listed out, when dealing with this family, Mr. Habib should also explore about the their intention, whether they wanted to go back to their own country or not. After coming to Malaysia, do they want to go back to Myanmar again? So, we put two situations. If they wanted to go back to Myanmar, then they have to make the legal arrangements of sending them back to the family. But before that, Mr. Habib have to find out with the agencies in Myanmar whether it is safe for them to go back. Okay. On the another scenario, if they don't want to go back, they want to stay in Malaysia, what are the harms that need to be given to this family? Okay, it is listed over there. Okay. First thing is to seek medical attention for the father's hearing problem and probably provide a hearing aid. This is a medical support that we have to give for him. Find a job that suits the father. This is to further help them to get a steady income and for them to run their family, because they don't even have money to pay for the rental. Provide counseling for the mother who has been traumatized extremely because of all the problem that she faced in own country. Identify that which child who is having the problem. Here you can put as child one who have the learning disabilities, and provide a suitable education center or medical aid for that. And we should also make arrangements to send the child to school. Okay, all these things that we explained here is based on what a social worker can do. We look at the problem. We analyze the situation. This is the problem, so this is the solution we're trying to tell.
Means this is the basic problem that we can that the social worker can play the role, such as educator, facilitator, and so on. I think all of you will know about it.
So, whatever thing that we listed here is based on an ideal situation, in a very, very ideal situation. There's a medical problem, we provide medical support. There's an education problem, we provide. This is in a very, very ideal situation. But then in the reality, it is not possible to happen in a nation. Right? Even if it happens, it's only for a minimal percentage of it. Why? Guess. Why? Are we so cruel in Malaysia that we can't provide that kind of support to them? We always say Malaysia is a caring society. What's the real situation behind it? Okay. The reason is Malaysian haven't signed the Convention of Refugees. So according to our Immigration Act, we don't recognize refugees. Anybody who is coming into the Malaysian border without a legal documents, they are categorized as illegal immigrant. Whether they are coming in the context of refugee or really illegal immigrant, or whatever context, if they don't have a legal document, they will be categorized as illegal immigrant. So what happened to these refugees is when they're stepping into the boundaries, Malaysian border, they are still considered illegal immigrant. But, there's a big but, on a humanitarian ground, Malaysia is helping the refugees by providing basic needs for them. This is being done in the detention centers, where most of the adults will be in the detention center, and the children will be sent to shelter homes and whichever organization can provide protection for them. So this is the...
But Malaysia signed the UNCHR, which you mentioned.
Yes.
So?
When they signed the UNCHR, this is where we are providing...
So that means that the two children can be taken care of, not the mother and the father.
Yes.
So you got the point. Malaysia has not signed this, but Malaysia signed the convention.
Yeah.
So that means the social worker at least can protect those two children. I don't know.
Yeah, and they can be sent. The two children can be sent to a home. I'm very sorry, we don't have the final vision here. There are certain homes which provides service for this kind of children, refugee children, especially from the Myanmar. But even the education that is provided there is not on a not on a formal education list. It is a community service that they are doing. Volunteers from Malaysia and they are volunteers from Myanmar who is conducting the education, informal education for the children there. And mostly adults will be detained and it will be in the detention center. So the when we are studying about, we are doing it on a humanitarian basis. It is because we have signed the United Nations UNCH High Commission for Refugees. So we haven't
so you're saying is Hamid first should work with the children using this convention.
Yes.
And put them wherever, in the school or in some sort of office. Send them.
And that only he can look for, he has to explore the possibilities of providing medical and counseling support for the father and the mother of the family.
Okay, what else?
And okay, and to be, we were shocked when we got this thing and we went to look for some information that Malaysian refugee, there was a survey done in 2006, World Refugee Standard, and Malaysia failed all the six categories of refugee protection. We failed all the six categories. Yes. Okay, so that's what we got to know that we haven't improved much in the protection of refugees.
So you want to conclude, so what should we be doing?
Yeah.
Maybe, something you want to conclude? What should Mehmet should be doing then? Mehmet is a social worker working with his family and he knew all this. So what he should be doing?
Okay, first of all, based on this UNCHR and also Convention of the Rights of the Children, so Mr. Mehmet must focus on the children first, so send them to the shelter home and then get the support and the basic needs for the children. Then we, for the father and mother, also we use the UNCHR. And then he can find medical support and then also an equation for the father.
What about that the house owner that who is making comments on him?
Oh yeah.
So you just leave her like that.
He was complaining.
She's making a racial, you know, or
no, she wasn't making a racial, she was saying they're not paying the rental. And whenever they approach him, he seems to be unresponsive. So that probably because he's having hearing problems. He's asking and he can't.
Yeah, so what should the rent should bring with the time you want to ask one?
Yeah, as a social worker, we should help him to pay the
why you just negotiate with the house owner that okay, you know, rent he can't pay, please, you know.
We even thought of okay, when we put ourselves in Mr. Harvey position, we even thought should we bring the family out for the suburbs and bring them to the town area so that you know there will be more support and more.
What is the gap that more support?
Yeah, that's the reason. So according to them, prefer to because they feel they are more protected and you know they are not visible to the all the legal authorities.
And there's no free housing for refugees anymore.
Yes.
So where will you put them? We bring them out, we bring the family.
Yes, this
one. Maybe put them in another parent.
What currently Malaysian government is doing is the children are going to the homes.
Okay.
And the adults are in the
detention. You're separating the children and the family.
That's
do you think that's good?
But that's happening.
That's as a social worker, you would be doing that.
No.
You separate children with families.
No.
Now, questions, please. Yeah,
no,
questions.
We are not telling you we are going to do that, but that's what's happening here.
Yes, yeah.
That's what looks like possible. That's what they are doing here.
But I think we didn't do like that.
So, what do you do?
What? put my own money, get them a job.
First of all, I think if we can't move them from the rural to the from the urban to the rural, so we must negotiate with the owner of the house first, so that maybe she can give an excuse for this family to extend to pay the rent. Rental for a few months and so on.
This
one is the first solution. Second solution.
I will try to this is what we discussed. We will try to use the resources of the Malaysian Rohingya Society because they have a society which is working for the welfare of these people. So we will try to access through them whatever possible help that can be extended to them.
I think there's one NGO working for them. I think it's
the Malaysian Rohingya.
So you.
Yeah, that will be the agency that will be using to solve the problem.
We should be mobilizing resources from that NGO.
Yes.
Okay. Thank you very much. Can I ask Rosalina now what she thinks about the case, and then our friend will conclude, and then we can see what you know, we can learn. Thank you very much.
So this is our solution to the problem. This is our suggestion. First, to register them with UNHCR. Okay. Number two, seek for donation because they are the Muslims. We have zakat money. So yeah. Zakat. So we can ask because. Well-being of the child. Okay?
Basically, you're saying that Hamid also can do this. He can write a newsletter or send it to people to...
Yes.
these two analyses. They made an analysis, right? And they came up with their suggestions, their feelings, or whatever. What do you think? Is there any difference between these two analyses? What was the approach used by Safina and Basumati, and what was the approach used by Safina and our friend? Is there any difference, you see? You see any difference?
What?
Wait, I want to ask you. Yeah. Huh? You see any difference? Huh? Otherwise, we'll ask our friend. What do you think? Can you give us your ideas now?
I have an idea about the difference between the two, but I have an experience dealing with the refugees when I am practical in a hospital. Okay, in reality, a social worker in hospital. Okay, I've got a case about refugees that have an accident and then they become a disability. And then the employers didn't want to become a responsibility for this guy. And then as a social, my senior is in the hospital. Cannot find his employers to settle the hospital fees because he always stays in the hospital around 2 months. Wow. So for refugees, the pay is very expensive for the refugees, especially. Okay, and then I see the solution for this case. Contact with the immigration custom. Okay, is it custom? Oh my god, and they say immigration. Okay, the immigration, and then they call them, and then come to the hospital, and then see this patient, this refugee patient, and then they come, and then they see that the refugees are already disability, but they still can wake up, and then walking slowly with a walking frame, but it's already become a disability, and then his mind is beating much shock like that, and then these refugees. After 2 weeks, deal with the immigration, and then these refugees already sent to the depot, detention center, to send it back to. He's a Bangladesh man, the Bangladesh guys, and then send it back to Bangladesh. And then when the policies in Malaysia, when the refugees already sent to the detention center, and then the pay for the hospitals very. So this is the solution when my senior have a solution to settle down there about this refugee's case, because I think there is nothing for this here that they get a final job or counseling. Yeah. They just send it to the detention center and then send it back to the Bangladesh and then they settle. Because as a social worker we have a lot of cases, and then the other case is waiting for us to. Find a solution for this case, and then we cannot stuck in this case only, and then because we have a lot of cases to settle.
Okay.
And then that's my experience.
So he's telling us what is happening on the ground.
In the reality.
In the reality, which is very good. Thank you very much for that. And also tell us what is the thing that you have seen in these two presentations.
Okay. What I can see. This group didn't say about the using a zakat. They are Muslim, but in my opinion and my experience dealing with the zakat, okay, they just give for the asnaf group only for one shot. Especially not for zakat for rental is not applicable for in zakat. Actually, they just give a one shot, 200 ringgit, and then it's finished.
Yes.
Okay. That's my opinion about the zakat. And then the others, I think I like this point. Malaysia failed 6 categories for refugees protection. And then what we need to do? Very simple word, policy change.
Yes.
That's all.
Thank you very much. Any other, come back. Any other audience?
Audience.
What do you think? What are the main approach they have taken in the analysis? Not knowing any policy analysis tools, you know? You just did it, you know? With your whatever experience that you have, whatever understanding that you have, you just analyze. Both approaches to me seems okay. Even group one, okay, they said this. and this is what should be done. Group 2, they also have some of the interesting suggestions, newsletter, this and that. What do you think? Do you see any differences in these approaches, in these analysis, or both of them the same? Maybe we should do both. We should focus at the micro like they have done, but at the same time also focus at the macro level. Okay? What else? To me, group 2 have used a lot of values, you know, the cultural values, Jakar, you know, that's where we were discussing in the morning. No, you have tried to use the resources that are already existing in the society. You know, there you brought in cultural values, religion values, how these values can be a solution to an issue like refugees. Whereas the group 1 has brought a lot of legal, solutions. UNHCRC, UNHCR, whatever. So their approach is more legalistic. Whereas group 2 approach is more religion, values, culture. Agree or not? Both of them are correct. Now maybe use both. You do UNHCR, UNCRC and also Jakarta. Possible. As a social worker, no one is stopping you. So maybe you do that. What else? Now we are getting into this?
Yes.
Okay. So micro focus, macro focus. Religion values or religion, internal resources, more on legal, instruments. That too, global legal instruments. At the same time, they're also using Malaysian acts also, which is very good, So that means as a social worker, you should have the global conventions, global, legislation, and then your state, also. At the same time, your religion values and cultural practices, resources that are available in a particular country in society to address this issue. What else? There's another thing that they have done, I think, very clear. The approach. What do you think? They said, this is what for father, this is what for mother, this is what for children. What do you think? The group 2. Huh? And what is that they have done? The group 1? You see such. You see that? Do you think that helps? For example, licensing. Maybe, the whole family should be referred to JKM. And that's it. Not like father, mother, children. But I just submit the whole family as one case to one referral center. They will send to the detention center, so you don't want to do that. That's why you have not done that.
Yes.
So how do we see this family as a unit? Or a family has multiple issues,
yes,
multiple problems. The father has deafness, the children have autism, the mother is stressed out, and they're not able to pay. So it's an economic issue, it's a health issue,
yes,
it's a legal issue. So maybe both of them, I think, looked into these things, or what do you think? Or one group can look more into that than the other. Any other things that we can see? What social values this two groups brought in? If you see, this group 1, do you think they're using more professional things than the group 2, or both the groups are using, the principles of social work or values of social work? Who is using what? Today morning we're discussing that also.
Go ahead.
Huh? What do you think? You groups, you can tell us now. Do you think you have used all the social work values there in addressing this issue? Huh? I have not heard any word that Hamids should consult with the family what they want to do. I have not heard of that. Have you heard?
No.
You thought about that? Like consult or have a discussion with the family first. And then ask why, what is an issue, how can I help you?
Yeah,
I'm a social worker. Hi, hello, I'm Swamir, I'm a social worker. I'm working in this area. Can I help you? Do you want my services? You know? And this is the issues. And then there are, you know, 2-3 sittings. And then, okay, then father will come up with his own idea. Something like that, consultation. You start prescribing. Both groups looks like start prescribing, you know, suggestions. I have, maybe you have thought about it, but presentation
yes.
may not came out, maybe.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. Mm. You must ask them whether they want to be in Malaysia, or they want to go back, or they will
ask. Then you're focusing on, you know, you want to be here, or you want to go back. So you're already offering a suggestion,
our
a solution.
No, our assumption was.
Why should you ask that, for example?
Our assumption was this thing came out after we discussed with them.
No, it doesn't say yes. Then I have to change the case study. I'm also improving this case study so that it can be used by anyone, by other also. Is that the impression comes?
Yes.
Yeah?
We assume that we have it already getting
No, I don't think so. But the last question is, Mr. Habib, the social worker, is trying his best. Trying his best to ensure that all the family members receive benefits they are entitled to. He's trying his best. He is trying to find another place to live where the other Burmese are living so that, you know, this can be resettled inside. What are the steps that, I just gave it to there. What are the steps that Mr. Habib should be further taking in order to help the family? If you were in Habib's position, what steps will you take to help the family and to secure their rights? What policies and acts should you know? I think the last question you answered very well, not the second group, for example, you know. You didn't focus on this. Whatever it is, case studies will help us. There are real life situations. Maybe we will revise this. Maybe the first phase is that he will assess the whole issue. And then he, the usual social work, you know. Okay, these are the assessments that I made. And what these are the solutions I can prescribe or suggest. What do you think? Maybe, you know, you can have a session with the children, a session with the mother, session with their father, and together the whole family, another, you know, one or two sessions, and then come up with certain assessment or an action plan, whatever you call it, agreement, and then he'll start working not by one, but at the same time. He'll be working for father, he'll be also referring to the mother, taking family as a unit within the, you know. So this is, you know, the way we analyze also depends on what we believe in. You believe maybe in this system, this is what works, this is easier, raising resources is easier than asking for UNCHR. For them, maybe UNCHR is the final answer because that is the international board, legitimate body that can help. It's up to you what approach that you make, it's up to you. But as a social worker, you're using your analysis, your social work values, your social work principles, your cultural values, your client values. Maybe they say, please leave Habib, don't worry about us. Will manage. What do you will do? You will leave or you will still continue to do this?
Still.
You will still continue to do this. Why? Because the client self-determination. They said they don't want your help because you are not a Burmese, you can't understand their problems. We want a social worker with a Burmese background. That's what the family said. What do you will do?
At that point we should leave.
At that point we should leave the family. We should not get in
on
that day.
Leave the number or what contact you have, but in that day or after 1 or 2 days, how is your situation?
Go back.
How is your situation? Can you manage?
Why in that situation he should leave?
Because at that we should respect the decision of the client.
Okay, but then going back, you are not respecting the client's decision.
No, when he's saying you are not, you won't understand that he is in a very degraded situation.
What is the guarantee that he will change his mind? Okay, you came after 2 years, again you are irritating me. I said I don't want to see your face. In US, 2.4 social workers are abused by the clients. Abused, marked, beaten by the clients, or, you know, threatened by the clients. It's possible. It's possible. So what do you mean? You leave the job? What the hell, yeah? I'm trying to help these guys, and they're saying me, you know, as if, you know, my job is just because, you know, there are refugees here. People say that. Well, you guys have a lot of jobs and high flying jobs and dollars because we are poor, and you want us to poor all the time.
I think it's one step we have to accept this decision made because we can't serve both world hunger.
The answer is there's no one right answer here. So if you are a social worker, maybe you will go back. Maybe you will not go back. Maybe you will try and find another Burmese social worker and go with him. Or I don't know what you will do. It all depends on your knowledge base, the context. Maybe your organization will have a policy that, okay, if they're not interested, we're not going to take their case. No more. Thank you. Just refer to some office. There's a family in danger. Maybe go to the police or to the hospital and then close the file. You don't know. So what is happening here? When you're making decisions, when you're making choices, when you're making, whatever advisors, whatever your action plan, on what basis you are making this?
You are bringing in all this file.
Okay, that's one thing. Another thing, how do we understand this refugee policy analysis? How do we understand refugee policy so that we can help this family? How can we understand housing policy so that we can help them better? How can we understand unemployment policy so that we can help the father? How can we understand medical services so that we can help the mother? To understand this, at least you should have in-depth knowledge about five policies. The housing, the refugee policy, the medical policy, the education policy, and maybe another services. One social worker should have this minimum five if you are working in this refugee sector. Is that clear? You agree? Then how do you do analysis? Remember those analysis we made? The stories, the networking types, the fixing. Maybe here you should be a fixing kind of, how do we fix? Which provision of refugee thing I will mobilize? Maybe the UNCRC. I will mobilize and at least put the children, some protection to start with. You write something, okay, UNCRC, Malaysia, signed, so it is a state responsibility for these children. Can you do something? You ask JKM to immediately do something. So there are other policy analysis that I would like to introduce now. You want to take a small break or shall I introduce? There are basically two ways that you can do. All these policy analysis that we are talking can be classified into two types. One is, how do we do this? Yeah, this is, we discussed it already, so I'll just shift this. So, how do I go here?
The arrow.
Okay. Okay, policy development also we discussed. It's the policy analysis. Yes. I'll explain that other one if your time permits. All these policy analytical tools can be classified into two types. One, a descriptive analysis. The other one is a process analysis. So in this, what kind of analysis you guys must have done? Knowingly and unknowingly. You have done descriptive analysis, you think? You think you did a descriptive analysis, right? What do you mean by that? Descriptive analysis can be further divided into four types. Content analysis, choice analysis, apparent analysis, and historical analysis. And there is another way that process analysis. So just from this slide, apply to your case, what you must have done? You said descriptive, right? Within the descriptive, what is that you must have used knowingly and unknowingly? Content, the very word content analysis. Choice analysis. What else? Comparative analysis. And historical analysis. I think Rosalina is trying to get into the history. Remember? In her newsletter, she is referring to the very issue. Why these guys, has become refugees. She's getting there actually. She's making a historical analysis. Knowingly and unknowingly. Why she has to do that? Why she has done that? Should be doing that? What is the help? What is the benefit? We need a historical analysis. Where is the problem? How many of these Burmese refugees are, where are they? Are they also facing the same issue or not? Or this only this family? If others are doing well, why is this family not able to do well? We're getting the history of this. Maybe that helps. Knowingly you're already doing that, actually. That's not policy analysis. But you guys are not interested in that at all. That's also fine. You guys are interested in what?
What can be done?
What can be done? Can you fix somewhere there?
Okay.
Huh? You are more into content. You want to look at what UNCHR says. What UNCHR says, whether you know those policy provisions can be applied in this case or not. Okay. Two different things. Both of them are legitimate actually. But as a social worker, imagine you know a historical analysis and you also know a content analysis. And you use both. What would have happened to this family? By law. Definitely the case would have been better. Because you're looking at the case, very root cause of the you know the very refugee issues, and at the same time you're doing something else. So as a social worker or a social policy analyst, these are some of the tools for us to further understand the issue. So I'll go by one now in next 1 hour. It's very easy, it's not very difficult. Then you come back. Okay? Yeah, please. Yeah, please. Your answers will be much better. Your understanding of the case will be much deeper. I'm sure it will happen. You just go back and reflect, do the scribbling. If I want to kind of do this, what all I have to do, checklist. Okay, now first I'll understand the UNCHRC. I'll understand the UNHRC. I'll understand the Malaysian laws. Maybe you guys will see, oh, religious point is good. What is the jihad? I'm not a Muslim, but I'm a social worker. But I should now know what is jihad. How can I mobilize jihad? Maybe you guys will think on that. So this is what analysis, which helps you to help the clients better.